Hello, everybody, and welcome to Music Motion. My name is Drew Schnurr. I'm an assistant professor of composition and media at the University of North Texas. And I am thrilled to welcome you all here today and to introduce my friend and partner, Olly Blackburn. Olly, greetings to you from the Dallas area.
Greetings back to you. I've crossed the Atlantic and I'm now in Los Angeles.
You're all over the place, man. I can't keep up. But
yes. Yeah. But my one constant is the University of North Texas in the Dallas area.
I appreciate that.
That's my fulcrum. That. Yeah.
Well, we've got a great conversation planned today with Andy Milburn of Tom and Andy, and I'd just like to pass it right over to you now and talk to us about what today's topics are going to be.
Fantastic. Greetings, everyone. Greetings, UNT students. Greetings, music lovers, film lovers, and lovers of film and music, music motion lovers. So just to kick off today's session, which is going to be really interesting, I want to read you this comment that was made from a national press advertisement by the American Federation of Musicians in 1929. They took out this advertisement, which said, "Theaters in many cities are offering synchronized mechanical music as a substitute for real music." And that's capital R, capital M, real music. "If the theater-going public accepts this vitiation of its entertainment program, a deplorable decline in the art of music is inevitable. Musical authorities know that the soul of the art is lost in mechanization. It cannot otherwise be, because the quality of music is dependent on the mood of the artist, upon the human contact, without which the essence of intellectual stimulation and emotional rapture is lost." Now, of course, in the silent era, all music had been played live to motion pictures by either a pianist or an organist who was following the action on screen as they played their instruments. This mechanization of music to picture, which was the advent of recorded synced sound, was a complete paradigm shift. I don't think we fully kind of realize it in the world that we live in, but it brought with it a completely new way of listening to film and to music. And with that new way of listening came this completely fundamental question: does the music design the image, or does the image design the music? Now, that's something that our guest today, Andy Milburn, has spent his career exploring. He started off as a music student and experimentalist in the late 1980s in New York, and together with his partner, Tom Hadju, from Tom and Andy, who built a career and an amazing body of work exploring this central idea. They're best known for their really quite seminal scores in horror and thriller films, in particular The Strangers, The Mothman Prophecies, and Resident Evil franchise. But they've also traveled across a plethora of sonic worlds, and we'll be hearing a lot of those and discussing them over the next couple of hours. They're also, very interestingly, pioneers in new frontiers of sound and visual expression, contributing to the music language CMIX at Princeton and holding patents derived from their development of AI music systems and systems for managing network collaboration and medical sound systems for helping the blind. So with that all in the bank, without further ado, I would like to introduce Andy Milburn. Greetings, Andy.
Greetings. Hi, Olly. Good to see you. Hi, Drew. Very excited to talk to you guys today. What a fantastic quote that was to start with. You know, it's easy to forget now that it wasn't just always this way. But, you know, think for a moment about silent film. It was silent. There was no music, except there was. There was always music. There was a pianist or an organist sitting in the back of the auditorium playing along with what was happening. We kind of blur over that. It seems like there's a logical progression from that to just adding recorded sound to film. But it's actually, I think, a really fundamental change for a few reasons. I don't think that that advertisement by the American Federation of Musicians is just because they're worried about losing their jobs. I think that they actually sensed that something radical was about to happen when recorded music was going to get attached to picture. And I think the central thing that shows up is, where is the music coming from now? You know, in the silent era, the music is coming from the audience. It's coming from vaudeville, actually. You know, it's coming from the same place that music always came, in the theater. It's an obvious accompaniment that's being done in real time by real musicians who are actually, in general, facing forward like the audience. They're sort of peers of the audience, you know, cohorts. There's no mystery. There's no question about where the music belongs, where it comes from. The minute you record it and you hide the musicians away and you turn the speakers around so that now the music is coming from the picture and not from the audience, it raises a whole bunch of unsettling questions about what does this even mean? You know, when people first started doing music scores to film like this, the common expert opinion was that it would just never work. The artifice was too great. It was too weird an idea. Why? There's no music in the real world when people are walking around doing things. Why would there be music in movies about people walking around doing things? It just doesn't make any sense. And it took a while for the idiom to kind of emerge. And I just think that's fascinating. And I think that quote is really powerful. I will also just suggest, as a small spoiler for the end of the lecture here, the discussion here, that I think we're at the brink of another revolution like this. And we're staring down the barrel of another disruption in the way we think about what music even is and how it accompanies the moving image.
Right. And I look forward to discussing that with you, because I think you're right. And in the same way that it's hard for us to fathom, like growing up with someone playing piano to a screen, and then suddenly the screen, as you said, is talking back to you. What's going on right now with these new technologies is a similar paradigm shift.
You know, if you think back to the musicians in 1929, and now they look like, you know, they were just trying to protect their jobs and they were afraid of change. And, you know, look at the wonderful, amazing things we've done in the aftermath. Nothing was really lost. I mean, I shouldn't say that. Certainly something was lost. Something of that kind of vaudeville live theatrical experience was lost. And I'm sure that was, there were neat things about that. But it was replaced by something wonderful, which is film scoring the way we understand it to be. And I think that's what's going to happen again. I think we're going to lose this and something else crazy is going to happen. And while I don't think, I have an example I'd like to play, I don't think that this is necessarily where film scoring is going, but I think this indicates the kind of new music making and the kind of relationship to other people in musical spaces that is awaiting us down the road if we can just let go of our old habits. So this is a piece from TikTok. Many of you will be familiar with this, I think. It's Num Num Cat. This is Num Num Cat, though, in a sort of chain composition. One of the really interesting things about TikTok, right, is that it has music as its foundation. The initial vision of TikTok as a product was that you would lip sync to little short bits of music. And then later on, they discovered that you could do this kind of duetting thing where one person would do something and then somebody else would do something along with them at a later time. And even when they added that feature, they didn't anticipate this craziness, which is that you would duet and duet and duet, and you get this sort of infinite regress of nested duets accumulating a wonderful piece of music. So this is Num Num Cat as the core bit of musical sound and this glorious piece of music. Yes.
Oh,
as with so much, the future of music and film is going to be saved by cats.
Exactly, clearly.
Let's start this journey to that with your early influences in your early work. And we're going to play one of your very earliest influences, which is Roadrunner by Carl Stolig. So let's please play that clip. I love it. I love it so much. So tell us what this meant to you, what this meant to the young Andy, and how it influenced your future work.
Yeah, it was so important for me, I think. I was just fascinated by these cartoons, and I really loved the ones that had orchestra. I loved the Stalling pieces. They had so much life. I was probably 5 or 6 when I started watching these cartoons, and there was already classical music kicking around in the house, but to see it attached to this kind of action that I care deeply about, and to see the way that it added life and depth to, the experience of the coyote in particular, really grabbed me. And looking at it just now, I'm really struck by how, as we think about that quote from 1929, the American Federation of Musicians, this music is operating in the same way, right? It's a sufficiently skilled silent film pianist might have performed something very much like this, in the sense that it accompanies the action on the screen kind of from the perspective of a watcher. But I think you also start to see something else emerging here, which is the sort of interior world of the coyote that I think wasn't probably normally available, wasn't on the menu for silent film accompaniment. And I'll just add one other point I want to make. I always forget when talking about the silent film stuff how vital it was that those guys all had these little dossiers or little books full of episodic music that they had indexed by mood, sometimes by other sort of iconography, but generally by mood and action type. So what they were doing wasn't strictly improvising, but was kind of cutting and pasting from these little preset modules of music. And you can hear that in this Roadrunner stuff as well. Stalling worked in much the same way. He had to get this material out quickly. And he tended to construct these things modularly. And you can hear that at the surface of the music.
I mean, what strikes me is that this is music that it's telling the audience what to think. It's telling the audience something bad's going to happen. It's telling the audience, he's about to fall. It's telling the audience this hurts. But what really strikes me is also that the power of the music, that different sounds can, to the same image, can tell the audience quite different things. And that is immense power. And that brings us to one of your early works, which is Coco the Clown, something you did for MTV's Liquid Animation?
Liquid Television, Liquid Television. The early 90s, which was a fantastic, I know. What an experience. The MTV back then was a bizarre, renegade, artsy palace of young people who were poorly supervised and didn't really know what they were doing. You wouldn't recognize the MTV of today back then. And Liquid Television was this grand collage of crazy visual artists and musicians just trying to make stuff up that might fill in the late night hours of TV that was probably being watched by kids who were drinking and doing drugs. We got commissioned to write music for Coco the Clown. Coco the Clown is a Max Fleischer character. There are a series of Coco the Clown cartoons by Max Fleischer. They're quite dark. He's sort of the anti-Disney in a way. You know, these Coco the Clown things I find really disturbing. They were silent at the time and would have been accompanied by, a pianist or a small orchestra or something in the theater. And the idea was, well, let's do that now. Let's have Tom and Andy accompany Coco the Clown. But it was colored by, in addition to my early Roadrunner obsession, of course, which is clear when you hear the music. It was also colored by something that Tom and I were doing at the same time in New York. We had just opened our studio in New York. And we had just participated in a performance of a piece of music by John Zorn, a New York composer, called Cobra. And the way Cobra worked was, it was a sort of free improv ensemble piece. But there would be a director at the front of the room, typically John, although he would often franchise this out to other conductors. And the conductor, or John, would have these sort of cards with big icons on them, simple shapes, triangles, circles, colors. And in rehearsal, we would decide as a group, we'd improvise for a little bit, come up with a texture. John would hold up a card, and we would all be told, okay, remember that. Whatever you're doing now, that's what you're going to do whenever I hold up this green triangle. And we would do that. And then we'd improvise something else. Different things would emerge from the room. He'd hold up a different card. We'd remember that. So when it came time for the performance, John would just stand there and put up cards at abstract times. And the whole ensemble would move from one modality to our best recollection of a different modality. The effect was actually very Carl Stalling-like. You know, it was episodic. But it was weird because it was episodic, but the music was clearly improvised, clearly not written down, not planned, and it was a strange tension. So that experience colored the Coco the Clown scoring that we did, and we decided we would try and do the same thing. We would let Coco the Clown be John Zorn. The changes in the action in Coco the Clown would dictate when we would make a state change to some crazy industrial bizarre improv that we were doing. And so much of this was actually produced the way Stalling would have done it, left to right in real time. We were watching Coco the Clown as the conductor and making these crazy, weird electronic studio noises in sync with the picture. So yeah, take a look, and you'll definitely recognize the homage to the first of many homages to Stalling here in our work.
Great. Let's play the clip, please.
Thank you.
Can I just agree with you that Coco the Cat is pretty creepy?
Yeah. No, it's a dark vision. You know, the big compositional lesson for me of stalling and...
Can I just jump in? Sure. Can I just ask you, were you... Did I get this right? Were you guys kind of composing live to that picture? Were you kind of dropping in sounds as you felt it?
Yeah. Now, to be fair, we did it across multiple passes and then edited the result of that and cleaned up some synchrony. But we did try and treat the cartoon as the band leader, as John Zorn, as the dictator of changes in texture.
That's great. It's amazing to think.
And that for me, the takeaway, the big lesson from that is and continues to be, I came from a classical Western Princeton music tradition. As a serious Western composer. And this music, this approach to music allowed me to realize that musical structure doesn't have to be derived from sonata form in some mystical way, that you don't have to furrow your brow when you're trying to solve musical structural problems, that in fact, synchronized changes to almost anything produces something that your brain is happy to accept as a valid bit of structure. And that's more than enough to proceed, especially if you're working in the service of moving images.
Great. So I want to use this as a kind of springboard to go to your early career and your first films. We're going to show a clip from one of your first films, Killing Zoe. Would you like to just give us a little introduction to this and how you got
Sure. This was our first work on a feature. We didn't know what we were doing. We didn't know where we wanted the music to belong. Kind of apropos of what we were talking about a minute ago with the angry live musicians being upset that music was going to come from behind the screen. Where behind the screen was this supposed to be, this score? In early talks with the director, Roger Avery, it seemed like he wanted a kind of a traditional score. We actually talked about a woodwind ensemble as the one of the first ideas of what the soundtrack to Killing Zoe might sound like. As you'll see, we strayed fairly far from woodwind ensemble. And in the end, we went after something much more philosophical and subtle, I think. Roger's film work in general, one of the things he really seems to be fascinated by is things happening at the same time, things happening in parallel, maybe to two different characters. And you sort of attend to one for a while, then you attend to another. Meanwhile, you know something's still going on over there. And then at some point, they come together. And often at the end of very spectacular dramatic arcs in each of them, and then some crazy cataclysmic thing happens because they come together. And we wanted the music to kind of embrace that sensibility. And so you'll hear a little bit of that in this cue. This is about halfway through the film, where our two main characters have separated. One of them, the first you'll see, Eric Stoltz, is setting up his gear for cracking a safe. This is now something he knows how to do. He's on a mission. He's gonna put this thing together. He's stressed because they're in a bank, they're robbing a bank, and he didn't really want to do this, but he's on his mission. The other main character, meanwhile, is in a bathroom stall of the same bank that they're robbing. He's the leader of this hapless bank robbery, and he's setting up his drug rig to shoot heroin. He's a heroin addict, and he, in the middle of this bank robbery, is going to shoot heroin. And these things are happening at the same time, and we wanted the music to somehow connect these characters, even though their experiences are super different at this point. And we wanted the interleaving to be overt. we also wanted textures that were upsetting and harsh and modern, because that's the kind of film this was. And so you'll hear that.
Let's play the clip. It's amazing, even today, how avant-garde and ahead of its time that sounds. And I want to ask you, did you get any resistance from producers or, you know,
was this No, happily. We've gotten a lot more in the years since. Back then, you know, we were everybody on that project was young and crazy. And everybody did their own thing. It was fantastic. Yeah, really neat.
I'm going to chime in here, guys, because we're getting some nice engagement online here with the stream. We have a comment from, speaking of being young, right, in the 90s, I can relate to that, Andy. We have a comment from Amiability here. You can't see it quite so well. Let me put that up there. Oh, yeah. I can absolutely tell this was done in the 90s. So I guess we're doing a little bit of 90s nostalgia.
Yeah,
and I think a lot of the way that technology, I can hear the technology in that sound. You know, we had just gotten our first Akai sampler, so we could make loops, but only of a certain length, and we could only have a certain number of them because there was only so much RAM in that sampler. You know, yeah, you can really, all through the 80s and 90s, I find it really interesting to listen to the thumbprint of music technology, because it moved so fast over those years, and you can really hear it on the surface of the music still.
Yeah. And part of that is something that we're actually about to get to now, which was the kind of the imposition or the, you know, the heightened imposition of sound design in films. That there'd always been sound design, but the new technologies really allowed sound design to go to a new level, which I think also influenced your career, and we're going to come to that in films like The Strangers. But before that, let's take a look at another of your influences which directly speaks to this, which is from the movie Eraserhead. And for anyone who hasn't seen Eraserhead, I recommend watching it every 10 years. It's an extraordinary film that just needs to be revisited. And here's a piece from it.
Thank you. Said she's at her parents' and you're invited to dinner.
Oh, yeah? Thank you very much.
I mean, that drop in sound from the outside, from these industrial sounds just to the footsteps, my God.
Yeah. So tense and dark and weird. And, you know, at the time, not so much now, of course, but at the time, people had a hard time thinking of this as music. It seemed so musical to me at the time. It seemed to really hang in the air, that sound, and make the film feel a certain way. It was just, there's a dread in the air through the film, and it's these awful industrial tones. And Tom and I were listening to a lot of that kind of music at the time. We loved Throbbing Gristle, Butthole Surfers, you know, noise bands. We were really interested in music that you could make with noise and with sounds that weren't obviously musical. And one other thing about that just watching that now reminds me a little bit of you know, the John Cage 4 minutes and 33 seconds piece. The lesson there, right? His intention anyway seems pretty clear.
Let's describe it to the audience.
This is a piece by John Cage. Gosh, I'm not sure of the year. You guys have to help me with that. But the piece is meant to be performed in a concert. There is a score for it. But the piece is silenced. The performer is instructed to make no sound for 4 minutes and 33 seconds. And so going to see a performance of the piece involves going into an auditorium, you know, presenting your ticket, sitting down, the performer takes his place and then sits there for 4.5 minutes as you sit in the auditorium or the church or wherever you are. It was sort of taken as an aggressive and, you know, anti-art act at the time, but really, I think what he was up to, hearing him talk about it, it's pretty clear. He was very much interested in the sounds in the world and the way that how you listen to things changes your perception of the world around you, and that there is music available actually everywhere. You can choose to sit and listen to the traffic going by or the air conditioner droning away, the elevator in your nightmarish apartment building. And you can come to hear that as a kind of a music. And that was really the mission of 433. For me, for film music, this is especially powerful because if you can disguise your music as sounds from the world, you can get away with more manipulation of the viewer. You can be more subtle in the things that you're doing to the image. And I think, especially for the stuff we do a lot, which is unsettling thrillers, things that create tension and darkness. There's a powerful set of tools there. If you can creep around the back of people's consciousness and sneak in through the back door of what seems like the sound of the world and do musical manipulation of their mind.
Right. And the two genres which are reliant on that manipulation for their success are horrors and thrillers, yeah, and comedies.
True. Those Tati films. Oh my God. Yeah.
Those are the ones. So yeah. That brings us very neatly to one of your seminal films, The Strangers, which which really everyone listening here, everything Andy's been discussing, you can see it all played out in this clip. And then Andy can talk afterwards about the realities of it. And something that I think is very interesting that we do need to discuss, which is this is a commercial film. It's a very, very successful film. Mm-hmm. It was one of the most successful horror films of the year. And I think we should also discuss, you know, the industrial commercial process here. In what is actually a very avant-garde score again. Not quite as avant-garde as Killing Zoe, but still, for a Hollywood film, pretty out there.
Great. Yep.
What's your emergency? 911, what's your emergency? Are you there?
There are people here.
Okay, calm down. Where are you? What's your address?
I don't know.
Are you in danger?
Yes, yes.
What's your name?
Jordan. Please help.
Okay, can you tell me what street you're on?
I don't know where we are.
Jordan, who are you with? You found who, Jordan? Who did you find?
There's blood on the walls. Help us!
Jordan, calm down.
It's everywhere.
Jordan, what happened?
There's blood everywhere.
For you, and it's a question for so much of music, is where does the sound design end and the music begin? Or is that just a false dichotomy in this case?
Yeah, for us, we tend to not worry about that boundary too much. And in fact, we like early on to get into dialogue with the sound design team so that we can blur that boundary as much as possible. And we do end up producing a lot of stuff in the music department of the film that undoubtedly belongs as sound design. Room tone jumps out at me. You know, composers aren't usually in charge of room tone for good reason. Room tone is actually weirdly important and tricky to get right. But it is also, it's called tone for a reason. There's usually pitch elements to room tone. And we like to participate in those choices about room tone, if nothing else, to know what tones are going to be there alongside our music while we're writing for scenes like that.
Can you talk about how you came to structure that sequence? Because seeing it again, it made me think, if you took the picture away and you just played that, it could be like a Brian Eno piece. You know, it could be a piece of ambient. Everything's so together. How did you get to that in discussion with the director of the sound team?
You know, I will say again, I think where that, the reason that hangs together, I think one interesting thing about that piece and that kind of writing is it's right on the edge of falling apart. You know, a lot of Eno's great work is like this. You know, if it were 10% slower, it might just stop sounding like music anymore. If you left one drone out, it might just kind of fall apart for a little bit and you'd lose interest. It really is sort of stretched out to the barest threads. And we're doing that in service to the picture. That's the thing that guides us. So we look for the sort of signposts, the moments that we know we want to remark on or underline in some way. And then I remember that in working on this piece, Tom and I would just try and get from one signpost to the next with as little sound as possible. What's the least we could do? Because it felt like, and this also came from the director, from Brian Bertino. Silence can be so tense, and especially here at the beginning, once you've set up that dramatic phone call from the children, you know something terrible is going to happen later on in the movie. And really the best thing we can do is make you wait for that and make you imagine what's coming and leave you hanging. And we chose to do that by just spacing everything out as much as possible. And I will say, I think early on, we broke it a couple of times. It is definitely possible to be too quiet and to have too much space, and the whole thing kind of unravels. So we learned as we experimented our way through that.
You did, but I mean, I can't stress how influential this score was. I was doing horror films after this. This was a big score everyone was listening to. I personally think it drove a lot of thriller and horror scores after this. And that bold decision you made, as you've just described it, to go silent, when normally you'd go strong or you'd have a John Carpenter kind of pounding synth or something, really makes that film distinct. Really distinct.
Yeah, I think cheers.
Success.
Thanks. Yeah. Well, and I've got to credit Bertino as well. Bertino had the instinct for that, I think, you know, and it's in the script, you know, but thank you. Yeah, I think it's really effective.
Olly and Andy, we have a question that actually came in on a Twitch comment from Amy Ability again. She asks, who is normally in charge of room tone, if not the composer? And I think this actually really applies well to the implications of source sound, diegetic sound, sound design, and how those lines between sound and music are becoming more and more kind of ambiguous. Do you want to comment on that at all?
Yeah, I mean, the it's a great question, and the good news is now it's just kind of a free for all. It's a party, which is great because there's unlimited audio tracks. Anybody can suggest anything and put it into the mix, and it all gets sorted out. In the not too distant past, there were finite numbers of tracks that you could actually carry into the mix, and things were very tightly segregated, and the room tone would normally be strictly the province of the sound team. Usually not production sound, right? The tone recorded on location on set is usually useless because there's so much other crazy filmmaking machinery going on at the same time. So room tone is almost always artificial and pulled out of libraries by the sound team.
That's right. But, you know, and I'm discovering this on something I'm working on right now, a TV series where we have an episode that's highly musically driven. And we're having exactly this discussion. And the answer is it's not clear. It's a combination of both the sound, the post-sound designer, and the musician. And they will do like a baton run. Sometimes the music will take it over. Other times the sound design will take it over. And I think this is something that's really sort of developed in the last 40 years. And The Strangers is kind of actually the perfect textbook example of that question. It's a fascinating question. And just to sort of give a counterpoint to it, this brings us very neatly into our next clip from you, Andy, which is another thriller, 47 Meters Down, which is very sound design and musically driven, but is much more, you know, overt, much stronger, much more conventionally commercial. But it does address the same question: where, you know, who is in charge of the room tone? Who's in charge of the sound design? Is it the music? Is it the post sound? Let's play the clip.
I just don't feel safe in this cage. At least we got to see some sharks.
I mean, I guess so. It's just so cool. I can stay down here forever.
Hey, Taylor, once Lisa's out, can I go back down again?
What a secret. So talk us through this question: how you work with sound design, how you came up with this.
Yeah, well, you know, we learned a lot of tough lessons about action sequences in particular. It's funny because you'd think being sound design friendly composers like we are, we should love action sequences. But they're really hard. They're really hard musically. And part of that is because so much of the acoustic space is going to be taken up by screaming and banging and other noises. And I mean, any number of cues Tom and I have written over the years that we realized only at the mix stage, when all the final sound design came in together and all the screaming and everything and the music got smushed down to where it was ultimately going to be, that we realized that music doesn't work there. You can't have music that functions that way against the backdrop of all that violence and all that crazy loud noise. And we still learn that lesson. I mean, it's a tough one because it's action sequences are so exciting. They're so much fun to write, and music does help them. You know, music adds all this energy, but you have to figure out where you can live acoustically. And kind of unlike The Strangers, where you're trying to be subtle and blur the line between sound design and music, here in these action sequences, we're usually just trying to cover things like the big clanks and the bangs with our music so that we could replace whatever the big clank and the bang is that the sound design team is working on. And we don't always win that battle, but that's our goal often, is to make the music, in addition to carrying the musical energy, carry as much of the sound as possible so that it can survive.
So just to be clear, are you saying that some of those clanks there is stuff that you provided?
Yeah, most of that is music. The big bangs at the end are not. and the big chain at the very beginning is not. And I think everything else that sounds like a sound effect is part of the score, just so we could keep the score loud.
And do you ever listen to it without picture, just as a musical piece to get the cadences and stuff?
This is a great question. And yeah, it's seductive and dangerous to do that. We do it a lot, but it's really got to be careful with that, because you can lose sight of your place in the world, you know, action sequences in particular. We've written cues that we're so excited about. Look at how the running and the screaming is working, and it sets up the terrifying moment, and it's really captivating. But the minute you put the dialogue or the screaming or the guns back in, it all gets weak and all the stuff we worked on kind of dissolves. You really have to be careful and keep, we as a rule, try and write against dialogue and sound effects as much as possible.
Okay. I want to play another clip by you guys, which is a sharp veer left in terms of tonality. It's from a movie called The Details. And now that we've got to know you as these like hardcore action thriller guys, we're now going to play a comedy. So let's roll the clip, and then you can talk about this, which is, I think, quite fascinating. Yeah.
I make myself as a tasty fruit, and I would love to make your banana cry.
Neely, come here.
Whoa. What did this?
No idea. Say bye to me first. I gotta go. I gotta go to work. All right. Have fun today, okay?
Okay.
Okay, I love you.
Tonight, Doc. You're on fire.
Thanks, man. What happened to you? You're looking sluggish out there.
Well, that'll happen when you're 50 and working double shifts to make ends meet. But if you want to hit the weight room right now, we can see which one of us is stronger.
Oh, no, no, no. I don't want to embarrass you.
All right, Doc.
Okay, so we've gone far away from sound design now to the music designing the pace.
Absolutely. Oh, interestingly, we talked explicitly with Jacob Estes, the director, about Carl Stalling for this film. And I actually came to think of Tobey Maguire as the hapless coyote for much of this film. It's a dark comedy, and many things go wrong in his life. It's not slapstick, but it's got that kind of slapstick, darkly slapstick quality to it. We were overt in our homage to Stalling. There's some sequences there you can see. We're really doing that Mickey Mousing thing where he's crawling across the grass and we're going boop, 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 very much like Stalling would have done. Another component, though, two other things about this score. One is Jacob wanted this sense of the sort of clockwork of his out of control suburban life to always be kind of clicking along. You know, there's a lot of routine in his life. There's a lot of repetition. And things are supposed to kind of fit together. He's got everything figured out. He's got a good life, at least in the beginning of the film. And one of the things we wanted the score to do, in addition to making him the hapless coyote, was convey that feeling of a life that was kind of clicking and then starting to kind of malfunction. And the other thing about that score that we worked on a bunch was a very clear theme. We don't always do that. You know, classically, film scores tend to have motifs for characters or for ideas in the film. We'll do that, but often for us, those things are textural or episodic in some way and not so literally melodic in that sort of Wagnerian sense. In this film, there are motifs for all the characters, and they evolve and interact through the course of the film. And that was really fun for us to work on, especially with the Carl Stalling hat on.
So we have another great question, which comes directly at this from Devin. As we're talking about action scenes, how do you avoid melodrama or strict Mickey Mousing when writing against sound design?
I've got a trick that I'll offer. I mean, it is always a concern. And it's funny, you mentioned it in action scenes, it comes up a bunch. In fact, Tom and I have a standing rule that we're not allowed to do any bass lines that descend by whole tones ever again, because we've done it once or twice and it's such a cliche and it just, it's just embarrassing if you notice it. And there are all kinds of cliches and tropes like that you want to try and avoid. And then two, Mickey Mousing, I get that as well. That's its own, rat's nest of problems. So a trick, one thing that we'll do a lot of times if we're wrestling with a sequence like this, is we'll throw in a piece of music that we didn't write that doesn't belong with the scene. In fact, that we're pretty sure isn't going to fit very well. And we'll just glue it up against the scene as if it was the score and force ourselves to watch it a couple of times. And what happens is you discover moments in the scene, especially in these action-y things, that maybe weren't your first ideas, moments that you hadn't quite picked up on before, or ideas about the way the pacing could be different than the obvious pacing that the scene seems to dictate. And so a lot of times we'll throw crazy pieces of music that seem like they have the wrong tempo and the wrong shape and discover accidentally ideas that will prevent us from doing the rote cliched trope thing that's in our head. So you can undermine, you can sabotage yourself by throwing random noise, random music into the machinery of your own consciousness.
That's a great tip. And in a different field in directing, often if you're doing a scene with actors and for whatever reason, just not nailing it, sometimes a great way out is go, hey, I know it's a tragic scene, just try it as a comedy, see what happens.
Yeah, right, great.
And
yeah,
something about doing that releases the artistic kind of energy. Yeah. And that actually does bring us to our next clip very beautifully, which is one of the great examples of this kind of counterpointing the music to the image. And it's this very famous Blue Danube clip from 2001.
Great.
So yeah, Let's play that and then we'll talk about how it influenced you. Thank you. So I believe the story behind this is that Kubrick did the sequence, scored it, had a composer, was not happy with the score, and ended up serendipitously, what we've just been discussing, putting it to the Blue Danube.
Yeah.
Which I guess does make this a sequence that is designed to the music.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. So two interesting things about that. Right. It's actually what we were just talking about, that you can impose a piece of music that wasn't built for this purpose and discover these crazy, magical things hiding in the picture and hiding in the music. And that's pretty clearly what happened here. Sure, I imagine, I don't know for a fact, but I imagine that the sequence was then re-edited once he settled on Blue Danube. But I bet 90% of it happened the first time he dropped it in there. I mean, it's just magic. And this happens all the time. You know, it's kind of the Wizard of Oz, Pink Floyd trick, right? That if you start the Dark Side of the Moon at the same time as the Lion Roar of the Wizard of Oz, there are all these crazy synchronies that emerge over the course of about an hour. It happens all the time. You can, and that's what I was saying earlier. Do this for yourself. You know, if you need new ideas or to avoid cliche, just throw something up there that shouldn't work, and your mind will make it work. And in doing so, you may discover something new. There's really something so powerful, especially about, I think, music that has its own life force, that has its own logic, and then putting that against moving image that also has its own internal logic and structure and flow of time, and watching your mind stitch those things together somehow so that they can live together. I think I'm endlessly fascinated by that, and I think it's a really powerful trick.
Can I just say I love what you just said. It's these two separate life forces. And actually, I take back what I said. This wasn't designed to the music. It was that synchronicity that you talk about, that serendipity. Yeah.
Right. I mean, to be fair, I think there probably was some nipping and tucking after the fact. But I think the magic alchemy, you know, the alchemy, the moment of magic, was these two powerful things collided together and made a new thing. It's crazy.
Okay, let's play another piece by you guys, which is your title sequence to The Silence.
Great. Great. Yeah. So, you know, what's interesting about that is it's more of the same in the sense that we are trying to synchronize our music to a pretty visually rich and, you know, clearly defined sequence of visuals. So like the Roadrunner, like the details, you know, we're doing some Mickey Mousing, if you will. But here we really wanted it to, having made peace with allowing the musical structure to just follow the picture and for it to be a little ad hoc and a little jerky, in as with the details, for example. Here we wanted it to be as musical as possible. We wanted to smooth off those rough edges and make, even though we were making abrupt changes and scoring lots of little events in the picture musically, we wanted to try and make that have a musical spine that flowed from the beginning to the end. And of course, that's trickier. That's more like a playing Tetris or solving a little jigsaw puzzle or something to get those things to fit together. But that was the challenge of that score, was to try and do both of those things. Oh, and I've got an anecdote about that. There's a little bit of sort of inside baseball behind the scenes story. Robert Kultzer, one of the producers on that project, very musical guy, very smart, very musical. And he had early on suggested pipe organ, church organ, for the score in general and for the opening in particular. And it was a smart suggestion. There in the film, there are themes of religion. There's actually a church where some climactic action happens. So it made sense, but the score to Interstellar was hanging heavily in the air for me. I was really nervous about that because there had been so little, pipe organ just doesn't come up very much in film scoring. And I really worried about using organ and having it sound like Interstellar. And the first few things we tried, it sounded just like Interstellar. It was terrible. It was so embarrassing. And Robert kind of put us out of our misery. I don't think he would consider himself much a musician, but he pulled out a MIDI keyboard and noodled around a little bit with a pipe organ patch, doing something I would never have done. And again, this is kind of like the 2001 idea where you try something arbitrary. He just did some noodling. Would not have been my first thought at all. And it worked. It's actually very much what you hear in the beginning of that clip, that kind of John Adams style sort of arpeggiating organ pattern, was really Robert's idea. And I think the lesson there for me, and we learned this a bunch over the years, is just be available and open to ideas from wherever they happen. You know, this in filmmaking, people cross their lines all the time, and it's great when it happens. You know, the sound design team often has an idea that is different than what we would have thought of for the sound, and we are always open and available to that. And if a producer or an actor or somebody has some musical idea, great. You know, it mainly because it may break us out of some, you know, unpleasant pattern that we're in and make us think of something a different way. And I think that's really, really valuable. And one of the great things about working on films is there are teams of people collaborating. You know, it's you can do so much more with a team than you can by yourself.
Yeah. And it's be open to the happy accidents, because as we've seen from that clip with the organ and from 2001, where presumably Kubrick was tearing his hair out and suddenly heard a waltz playing, you know, the happy accidents. And that's something that Daniel Pemberton in our first episode talked about quite a lot.
Yeah.
So that brings us to the next sequence of clips that we want to show, which address something that in this episode you've talked, it's been really the common theme, which is how much music can change the shape of the images and how both those can be arbitrary choices, and also you can refine those choices. And we're going to do that now through your opening titles to Lucky Day. And I'm going to open it to you. You're going to introduce each one and talk about what you began with and how you got to your end kind of result on that.
Great. Yeah. So this is the fairly short title sequence to Roger Avery's Lucky Day. And where we started was where we often start as composers, which is with a temp track. Roger had put in this kind of surf themed thing that I'll play here in a second. And we always feel like our first job is to try and dispel the memory of that as quickly as possible, to replace it with something completely different. It's kind of a duty. It's not always the right thing. You know, sometimes the temp is a good placeholder, but we always start viewing the temp as the enemy. So here's the temp.
Can I just ask you, is that like, we're all adults here. Is that like an ego thing? Just like, you know, we've got to be ourselves, or is it a more studied thing?
Yeah, no. Well, certainly part it is certainly part ego, and I am also perhaps overstating it. You know, so, many times the temp is a godsend because it explains something. It's a shorthand. It's a way, it can be a way for the director or the editor to explain how they think the piece is going to flow. But the reason we have that knee jerk instinct in the beginning is not even that it's necessarily going to be the wrong idea and that we wish we had thought of our own thing. It's that this terrible thing happens with temp music, which is that it's like an awful fungus that if it stays on the film long enough, it just seeps into it and you can't get it out. If you see a scene with the temp music too many times, it's really hard to forget it. And almost nothing will ever sound as good as the temp did. And so we try and nip that in the bud as early as possible, not just for our egos, but just to save the production from the nightmare of the temp music fungus.
Okay, and with that, let's play the clip and take it away, Andy.
Right.
Okay.
Great.
Temp.
So clearly works. And it establishes a mood, a tone. You can see why Roger chose it. Great. Okay. So let's play our first attempt, which is here we're just trying to do something different. We want to choose a different genre. Let's get rid of surf rock. I think this is sort of reggae, dub, electronic weirdness. Also, a running theme you'll see in the things we're trying. The footsteps, we feel like that's a rhythm. We'd like to have something to do with that rhythm. And it was kind of disappointing the way that temp didn't line up with the footsteps. So that's something we were working on all the way through. So let's play this first version, which is just trying to shake the fungus of the surf rock off the piece.
It's certainly different. What was the narrative?
Yeah. I mean, Roger's great. Roger loved it. But Roger had reasons for choosing the surf thing. And there was much about that genre that he felt was important to the film. So, you know, you have to listen to that, right? Thematically, the music is doing a bunch of things all at the same time. We reeled it in from there. I mean, to be fair, often our first effort in temp removal like this is really an effort to just bleach the landscape with something completely different to try and scrub your memory. And that's kind of what that version was meant to do. So here's a version that's a little closer to...
I'm going
to
be honest with you.
Yeah. So here's a version that's a little closer back to temp land. But, you know, I should say this film... This is a great film if you haven't seen it. It's dark and weird and trippy. And we felt like surf didn't do that justice. And so here we're trying to use some darkly cinematic orchestral texture to kind of let you know what's coming in the film.
Great. Thank you. Okay, right. Now that sounds good to me.
Yeah. And I misspoke. There's clearly no surf there either. That's another attempt to, you know, scorch earth and get rid of surf altogether. I like that too. That's very much closer to the feeling that happens later in the film. But to be fair, you know, does it resonate with that white space and the pace of the footsteps, you know? So the next thing we try is Carl Stalling. When in doubt, go to Carl Stalling. And again, just as with Jacob Estes on the details, I know I invoked the Carl Stalling name with Roger before this version. So here that idea is. Great. So weird. Yeah. Very Stalling. And you know, one of the victories of that pass is I think that sold the idea that, yeah, it's really nice to have the footsteps connect with the music. It makes it sound like a musical or something, or it connects the weird kinetic energy of the film with the music in a good way. So the next pass.
Yeah, just going back to one of our earlier questions, were those footsteps provided by you or were they from the production track?
That's a really good question. Those are production footsteps. We ended up using our own when we were working, but I think in the final mix, they went back to production. And, you know, a sound like a footstep, you know, I don't think our footsteps were materially that different than the production footsteps. So we didn't mourn their loss. Right. So this version is much closer back to the surf world. I mean, here we're starting to understand, talking to Roger, there's a reason he chose surf. It was part of the feeling of, you know, Lucky Day is actually a sequel to Killing Zoe. And there's a reason that there's some surf in the air. So, but here we're trying to hang on to some of the dark Mahler-esque heavy orchestra at the same time. This is actually my favorite version. This is not the version we end up going with. One of the many sad lessons of film composing is you don't always get your favorite child approved. But here's that version.
That is great. That's pretty surfy. Was it too surfy for Roger?
Yeah. No. It's funny. It is very surfy. It's got that Peter Gunn bass line going. I think it was maybe too big. You know, I think.
We have a comment from Amy. Sounds like a spy movie soundtrack.
Yeah, great. Yeah, exactly. That's definitely the genre. And, you know, that's a spy character walking down the hallway. I mean, it does fit. I think it was too big. I think part of what we realized talking to Roger is he wanted this this film to grow. And the beginning didn't need to be a blockbuster, you know, James Bond opening. That wasn't his vision for the opening. So here's the final version, what we actually do for the film. And it's kind of a hybrid. You'll hear it's sort of a scaled back version of the thing we just heard.
Sure. Okay, now having heard that, I just want to play the original temp track again, just so that we
Great.
can
Great.
do the full circle.
Yeah.
So,
Yeah.
thank you so much for sharing with this with us, because it's amazing to see the iterations and the pathways that you take.
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? And this comes up a lot. And I'll just say one little pro tip I have for wrestling with temps like this is early on, we figured the way to solve this was to copy the temp first and then mutate our copy. And that's an interesting approach. One good thing about that is you learn how to make music that way. We are in our very early in our careers, one thing we Tom and I would do all the time was try and copy a piece of music, not even because it was a temp, just because we were trying to learn how music gets made. And you can learn a lot of interesting stuff just trying to, very literally copy something that you like. That's a terrible approach in practice once you're dealing with a temp, with an actual temp that's attached itself to some picture. You'll never be as good as the temp. And you may get yourself into copyright problems. A much better way to proceed is to try and absorb the sensibility of the temp. Make yourself into that band, make yourself into that composer or that style. Try and absorb the mannerisms and the surface qualities of that thing, and then write your own piece completely from scratch. That work always solves, well, not always. Sometimes the temp is a fungus and you can't get rid of it, but when we've had success, it's always come from that approach.
That's great advice. And speaking from the other side of things, I know I do suffer from that disease of getting very attached to temp music, and why
It's
can't it be
natural.
like that? And well, it can't
Yeah.
be like that. And there comes a point you have to sever yourself and embrace
Yeah.
the composer. So we're going to take some questions, but before we do, I want to look to the future, because you guys are looking to the future as well, and with new technologies and all sorts of things. I want to
Sure.
ask you, how do you see the future of this art form? How do you see the future of the fusion of music with imagery, with everything that's going on right now?
It's a really interesting time, isn't it? I mean, you can see it all changing around us. Let me start with some dark observations, but fear not, it will brighten by the end. I think
It should be a weather forecast.
exactly. That's right. It looks like what being a film composer is under threat. I think it's likely that film composers won't be the same thing for very much longer. There are a few reasons for that. AI is certainly one of them. Tom and I've done a bunch of work actually in AI starting 20 years ago. We're fascinated by the ways that computers can learn about music making and can make music with you or in place of you. While the ML machine learning based branch of AI is kind of bogged down at the moment with natural language and music reproduction, I think it really is just a matter of time before AI systems are going to be able to produce quite good music. So what does that mean if you're trying to be a composer? Are you now just going to compete with AI entities for jobs? Are you going to be using AI as a sort of an adjunct and become more of sort of a music supervisor or something? And then there's a step beyond this that I think is disruptive, an even greater disruption probably, which is I'm not sure what it's going to mean to marry picture and audio in a fixed way going forward. It hasn't been that long that we've been doing this, right? We started with that quote from 1929 when what was happening was live improvised music was getting married on the fly, and every performance was different every time you went to a theater. it's only been, 100 years that we've been doing this thing where the score is always the same, which whenever you see the picture. And I think that's going to change. One particularly dark anecdote, Netflix, you guys may or may not be aware of this, but Netflix, when they started restreaming Dawson's Creek, changed the theme song. They couldn't afford to relicense it, and they put another song in instead. Fans were outraged, but what it revealed is actually this has been going on already for several years, that not just theme songs, but underscore and background music is often swapped out later in the lives of these products, TV series in particular, but we're already starting to see it happen with films as well. And so if even historical film scores are in flux and, and likely to change, I think that's just the beginning. I think that's actually where this all wants to go anyway. Think about this possibility. And I'm not suggesting that this is would be a good outcome necessarily, but we're not far away from you being able to watch a Marvel film scored with music that you like already. Scored with your favorite pop artists, sort of remixed on the fly as you're watching the Marvel film, and it would be different every time you watched it. Maybe if your mood's different, the score would adjust to that in this particular screening of the film, for example. So, what does all this mean for being a film composer? Is I think really the question. If I may make one bold prediction to sum up my bleak view of the future. I actually think it's exciting. And I think whatever film composer is going to mean in the future, my bet is that it'll be a lot less like Hans Zimmer and a lot more like that piano player in the silent film theater that we were talking about at the beginning of this discussion.
Brother, I love that. That is a quote for the ages. And we're going to go straight to questions from the floor with that, because I think that's a really inspiring line right from you. Before we do, we have another comment from Amy saying, cats rule the internet. And I'm not going to agree with that.
Clearly.
So let's bring our first question, a UNT student called Agustin, and he's going to come on and I'll let him introduce himself.
Hello, Olly. Hello, Andy. It's great to have you here. My name is Agustin Alonso. I'm a master's student at UNT, and I'm also an aspiring composer. I very much enjoyed watching the different musical iterations on Lucky Day's title credit. It really helps to see that the creative process is not always a straight line to the final product.
Great.
And speaking of creativity, can you think of a moment in your career where you felt your creativity was limited by an external factor, or where you weren't exactly doing what you liked the most, and what did you do then? And also, if that's something that never happens to you, what things do you do to ensure you're in track with engaging on projects you are the most interested in?
No, that's great. Thank you. That's really interesting. That's a great question. I mean, it used to happen all the time, and as a result, Tom and I have invented a bunch of strategies to save ourselves. Early on, we stumbled across the Brian Eno oblique strategies cards, which you guys may be familiar with. Those are super handy. I still reach for those periodically. Have you guys ever heard of Cornelius Cardew and the Scratch Orchestra? This was a project from, I think the 80s. I'd have to look this up. But the Scratch Orchestra, the premise here, and Eno was actually involved with them in the beginning, was they were a bunch of musicians, quite talented, but they weren't allowed to play their instruments. They had to swap instruments, and they had to perform on instruments that they were not comfortable with. And of all the sort of oblique Eno-y strategies, that's one that Tom and I fall back on a lot if we're stuck, because it has this, it turns you kind of into a child again. You kind of have to go back to first principles and figure out, well, I can barely make a sound now. How on earth am I going to make something that's effective or feels like music at all? And it will definitely not be something I've done before, and it'll definitely not be a cliche because I can barely get the thing to even make a sound. So, you know, games like that I find really helpful because without them, I absolutely fall victim to what you were describing. You can definitely feel stuck or feel, you know, the Lucky Day example reveals one of the truths of a working composer, which is that you're often on the hook to deliver multiple visions for a given scene. It's not just that you've been hired because you have such a particular and singular artistic vision that you're going to bless the production with your realization and that's that. No, I mean, sometimes, sure. But often you need to be able to produce a menu of solutions, especially when there are either, there's disagreement about how a scene is meant to operate, or you're in the beginning in the scene, there are different versions of the scene that might need to function different ways. So all of that to say, yeah, it's just good to keep an arsenal of little tricks and not spend too long stuck. I'll finish with my favorite Madonna quote. You know, this Madonna thing? Somebody asked Madonna how she approaches writing lyrics. And she said she has one rule. If it takes longer than 5 minutes, she stops and starts over again. And I think that's a handy one as well. You know, Tom and I these days rarely allow ourselves to get stuck more than a few minutes.
That is great. Thank you so much.
Sure. It's a good question. Wow.
So I want to actually chime in on that question because I think one of the things that for young aspiring composers, and we have a lot of them here at UNTU who want to be the next Hans Zimmer or John Williams, et cetera, is they have this idea about what it means to be a film composer. And it doesn't always necessarily equate to it's not about us, right? And I'm wondering, Andy, if you could talk more about how that, in a sense, it can be really liberating that I think good film composers are people who really love collaboration, right? And really love that process. Can you talk a little bit about how you frame your mind when you're collaborating with a director, a filmmaker, so that you stay supple and open creatively and don't get too attached to your work? I think a lot of young composers, they can spend a lot of time creating something and then they get really serious about it and they have a hard time receiving critical feedback. Can you speak to that
It's such a good point. This is critical. And in fact, you know, even now after all these years in those Lucky Day examples, I revealed the sad truth that I was attached to one of those versions. I felt like it was better than the one that was chosen. And I was sad about that for a little while. So that does happen, absolutely. But the thing that I've noticed is part of what makes me a lot more supple and is exactly what you said, Drew. It's collaboration. It's noticing that you're not actually writing music. You're making a film. And you've got a specialization, which is that you know how to make some musical texture that can support what the film's doing, just like the actors do, and just like the gaffer did, and just like the editor's doing. And the whole thing only really works at the end when it all gets melded together. And I'm excited to do that on a team. And I want to hear from everybody on the team about how that's going. And I want to hear from the director about what he's interested in. And suddenly when you start to do that, it doesn't feel like my piece of music anymore. It feels like it's the film's piece of music. And it's not, this is not my particular vision or brilliant idea. This is in support of the narrative that's going on. And that's, you know, I've heard Hans talk about this. The narrative is really the organizing principle, right? The story or the feeling. And if you marry yourself to that, your ego kind of goes away and you're free to just keep playing with that.
Great. We have another question for you. We're going to bring in Beige, and she will introduce herself, another UNT student.
Hi. My name is Beige. I'm an undergraduate student at UNT and also an inspiring composer. And I'm really interested in all kinds of intermediate composition. So it's been so cool to see all the different styles and genres that you've been able to work on. And looking at your score credits, I was immediately drawn to a specific one, and that's Resident Evil, which is a huge like film and video game franchise. And so having done the music for the fourth and fifth installments of the series, I'm wondering, how did you kind of approach the project like differently or similarly to other ones you've worked on, especially with the title being like closely influenced to a video game? Did that do anything to change your approach?
Yeah, no, really good question. That was a very interesting experience for a bunch of reasons. And not least of which, the video game. There's a weird relationship, I don't know how well you understand or have heard about it, between the video game and the movie franchise. They certainly share characters and some narrative material, but the creative teams kind of go their separate ways, and they just cross-pollinate a little bit at times of launch to make sure that the two franchises are more or less in sync with respect to who's still alive and what's kind of going on. So there was never any musical stuff coming from the video game side for us, but there was a legacy of, you know, three previous scores by the time we jumped on for number four. For me, for both of us, really, it felt like temp music. We had a similar relationship to it that we have to temp music. We were suspicious of it. We tried to embrace it because that's not really fair, right? It belongs. Temp music doesn't belong, and your job is to try and get it out. This music does belong because it's been in the franchise before. But in particular, four, but five as well, was aesthetically such a shift away from the previous films that we were pretty explicit that we needed to be careful. We needed to be suspicious of anything getting ported over from the earlier material. I'm actually just reminded of, we also worked on the sequel to Sinister, Sinister 2, and Sinister had a very particular sound, not so much a theme. What did it sound like? I can't remember it now, but Bugul, the villain in the film, had a thematic element that was as much of a texture as it was a sound. In that case, we really felt like our job was to take that on board and, you know, perpetuate it. And because he was still around, you know, and the aesthetics of the film was similar enough. So I guess the short version is, yeah, it depends on how sacred the artifacts are that are coming from the other material.
I mean,
thank you.
What strikes me about the Resident Evil stuff is that I'm not familiar with the game, but it sounds like it belongs to that game. It's dark, it's techno, it's driving, it sounds, you know, right.
Yeah, that aesthetic is certainly there in the games too. I don't know if you guys remember but the early games in particular were terrifying. They were actually very they were actiony, but they were also scary. They were spooky. And that never really, I guess, you know, to be fair, the first film had a little bit of that vibe too. But yeah, both franchises have their own arc and their own independent, you know, creative direction.
Thank you, Beige. Great question.
Yeah, thanks. That's awesome.
And I believe we have another question from Connor, who will introduce himself.
Hello, I'm Connor Simmons. I'm a double bassist and composer at UNT. And I've worked a little bit in film as a part of a team of composers. And that was a really interesting, experience for me. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about how that works for you and sort of the logistics of that and sort of the dynamics, especially with kind of a longer term partnership like you've had.
Yeah, sure. Great. Thanks. That's a great question. It's funny. Tom and I have been writing together since grad school. He showed up at grad school and we met and started working together right away. And, you know, in grad school, you're not really meant to collaborate that way. As a composition graduate student, you're meant to be pursuing your own, you know, vision. But music is uniquely collaborative, right? I mean, it is an art that that allows for bouncing ideas off of each other. And we were so different than everybody else in the department. We were really interested, as I've mentioned before, in throbbing gristle and recording studio techniques and stuff that nobody else really cared about. So we sort of naturally gravitated together. And I think, you know, one of the things that's made us good as a partnership is we're really different. So we know, you know, we're never on each other's toes. Tom writes these crazy complex rhythmic things. He's kind of, he's Mr. Propulsion. You know, he can produce the rhythmic underbelly of things. And I'm more harmonically oriented, I guess. So that made for a really nice combination. And I will also say that I think we worked on a bunch of projects early on, commercial projects. We did a lot of TV commercials in the beginning of our career. And those things require you to do lots of little things really fast. And it's, you know, it's kind of like sports or something. If you're in a little team of two or three or four people with a common goal, and you just support each other to try and get through those tasks quickly, you learn a lot about how to work together. You start to trust each other. And, you know, I think if we had jumped into feature films right away as a team, it might've been harder. You know, I think there was a lot of value in those early smaller projects and in learning how to be a team.
How long would you say you were doing those initial commercials and stuff before you?
Yeah, 10 years actually. Not to scare you, because I don't think it had to be that long. But we had a long career doing TV commercials, and we did a lot of them. And we actually had it wasn't just me and Tom. We would hire other composers to help us, you know, because that commercial work is super demanding, and we had to crank out a lot of material. We did learn a lot about how to collaborate. It's tricky, right? Because composing does, your ego is there. You're a performer in a sense, and you're kind of putting yourself out there. And I really think, for me anyway, the sports analogy was the one that always helped a lot. You know, we're all rowing in the same direction. You know, it's funny. I don't even know if this is helpful or not, but the fact that we were named Tom and Andy, I think gave us a weird little superpower. It prevented either of us from worrying too much about the other person getting credit, you know, because we always both just got the credit. And I wonder if that made it a simpler problem. Because, you know, early on, I know we both worried about what brand are we building here? Is this, there aren't really composers that are named this way. Is this foolish? Should we be, you know, going by our individual names? How does this work? And I really think, like a sports team, combining our interests and making it very clear that we were all pointing in the same direction helped a lot.
Cool. Thank you so much.
No, thanks. Good question.
Thank you. Thanks, Connor. Great question. And, thank you for your admirable honesty answering it as well. That's a, you know, this whole thing of collaboration and who does what, it can be a thorny issue.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
So, Andy, I'm afraid, as joyously pleasurable as this has been, and also incredibly thought-provoking, we're going to have to start tying it up. I'm going to say thank you so much for Music Motion to you, and I will leave you with the final word, at least on this discussion.
Thank you so much. I really had fun. Thanks so much. And I will just say, I think, you know, Num Num Cat. Num Num Cat is the future. Follow Num Num Cat, and you'll all be fine. Yes. Thanks, guys. That was really fun.
Thank you very, very much. Num Num Cat. You heard it. An orchestra of Num Num Cats. Okay.
That's great. Thank you so much, Andy.
How much food for thought was there? Everything from design of music and picture through, you know, the origins of music to picture to the future, where does sound design and music end and begin? All sorts of incredible stuff.
Well, and the importance of collaboration and creative, you know, they had such a vibrant creative practice doing all kinds of different work. And that's really important for our composers who are working in experimental realms. This is all relevant to all different kinds of contexts. So yeah, great conversation. Thank you. Thank you, Olly, and thank you, Andy. Olly, do you want to talk about next month? We have some, there are so many women doing great work in film. You've worked with this next guest that we have coming up next month, and I'm really excited about this next episode. Can you tell us about it, please, Olly?
Yes, our next guest is the composer Ruth Barrett, who I've had the great honor and pleasure of working on twice, on a TV show called Victoria and then on one called Sanderton. And Ruth is a fantastic musician. She is also one of the most up and coming TV composers in Britain now. And she is now stretching out to the United States. She did the latest season of offshoot of Law and Order and brought a very specific, unique sound to that. And she is doing right now a TV series called Terminal List, which is creatively driven by Anton Fuqua and stars Chris Pratt and will be a huge action-driven, you know, American TV show. She also did the score to a show called The Bodyguard, which was the most successful in terms of viewing numbers British show of the last 10 years and has a really, really powerful and kind of genre-defining score to it. And as Drew alluded to, she is also a female composer in an industry which is still shockingly underrepresented. I think, I don't know the exact figure, I think something less than 10% of composers are female, which is something that Daniel Pemberton alluded to in our first episode, and we'll talk a little bit about that. And then the final thing, which is really interesting about Ruth and really worth attending this, is that she comes out of something that we've alluded to before. She comes out of this apprentice system of musicians. She worked for a composer called Martin Phipps. She did her time with him over many years. And now as she becomes more successful, she's starting a similar system of her own. So she'll be able to talk in great detail for all you students out there, all you people who are about to start working in the industry, about how that particular studio apprentice system works and what the benefits are from it. So please join us for that. That will be next month, April 24th.
Thank you, everybody. We'll see you next month. Until then.
Peace out.